morning. On behalf of Sri Lanka Medical Association and the Expert Committee on Non-Communicable Diseases of SLMA, we welcome all of you for this important webinar. And that's on a different topic, different to the discussions that we had during this year. And this time we'll be discussing about traditional medicines used in NCD care. Where are we? So as I have mentioned, this slightly different topic, and because most of the webinars and the symposia that we have conducted was on COVID. But having said that, this is an important and a relevant topic. Why I want to say this, that is that at the moment, there are a lot of discussions about unethical practices or unsubstantiated claims that are basically promoted in the name of traditional medicine. So all these issues are there. So in that case, I think it's very important how we discuss what could be the role of traditional medicines and what is the proper pathway, what's the ethical and scientifically correct pathway in promoting traditional medicine. As Sri Lanka Medical Association, which is basically following the allopathic medicine, we are in supportive of the traditional medical system in Sri Lanka. Having said that, we strongly believe whatever system that we follow, it has to be based on very sound ethical and rational and scientific principles. That is the policy that we are working, and there is absolutely no deviation from that policy. So here also, the main discussion is that since there is understanding that the traditional medicine has been there in Sri Lanka for many years, and there's a need. Now the current situation where there are a lot of unscientific and unethical practices happening, the current situation again highlight the sound, rational and scientific approach towards traditional medicine. So today's focus will be on those areas to discuss what should be the correct pathway to be taken, regardless whether it is allopathic or traditional medicine. Again, I welcome all of you and the resource persons and my co-chairperson, who is the chairperson of the NCD Expert Committee of SLMA, Dr. Jayanthimala Jayawardhana, who will be co-chairing with me. Dr. Jayanthimala, over to you.
Hello. Today we are discussing the relevance of NCD with Western and Ayurvedic medicine. NCDs are basically hypertension, diabetes, cancers, and so on.
And today we have two eminent speakers who have special interest and also research expertise in both allopathic as well as the traditional medical system in Sri Lanka. Our first speaker is Dr. Priyanka Ranasinghe, who is a senior lecturer in pharmacology from the Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo. He is a senior registrar in clinical medicine. At the same time, his research interests include traditional medicines and herbal substances in NCD care. So this would be a useful discussion on what should be the proper approach towards researching into herbal substances. Over to Dr. Priyanka.
Very good morning to all of you, Chairperson Sir, Madam, and all of those who are joined online. At the outset, let me thank the SLMA and the NCD committee for inviting me here today to discuss about the herbal medicines that are used in non-communicable diseases, the current evidence and the future potential. Why I have put the native within brackets is some of the herbals that I'll be discussing today are not entirely considered native, but they are anyway herbals that are commonly used among Sri Lankans. So my presentation I have broken down into four sections. Initially, I will look at a little bit of history to see the place of herbal medicine in Western medicine, how the history relates. And then I will take you through the process of development that we follow in Western medical practices, where we adopt herbal medicine, when we adopt herbal medicines, taking into account my personal experience in the development of cinnamon for the treatment of diabetes. In the third section, I will discuss about several potential candidates that are used locally widely amongst the Sri Lankan population for obesity and diabetes, which I feel are two common and important non-communicable diseases that are highly prevalent in Sri Lanka at the moment. And finally, I'll conclude my presentation by giving few recommendations and looking how we can take things forward from where we are now. So at the outset, I would like to say that I don't consider myself an expert in this area. I'm not a botanist, for example, but I have done several research on non-communicable diseases. And I have some experience in use of herbal medicines for the management of non-communicable diseases. The second thing that I want to state is that I have no conflicts of interest with regards to the contents of this presentation. Okay. So what is the place of herbal medicines in the Western medical treatment? Now we know there are a lot of medical ingredients that have their origins, if we trace back several thousand years, to herbs. I can give you many examples: theophyllin from cocoa, codeine from poppy, and if you look at the World Health Organization essential medicines list, about roughly about 11% of the entire drugs that are there are actually derived from herbals, the starting point. And there are not only in Sri Lanka, there is a lot of interest in herbal medicines, even in the developed world, in countries like UAE, where there are products that are derived from herbal medicines, which are pending approval. And there are so many clinical trials that are ongoing with regards to natural or herbal based products. So this is nothing new. I mean, it has been there for many, many years, and it will go on being there for the years to come. So let me take you through one example to highlight few key two important points. Now we all know about aspirin when it comes to the management of myocardial infarction and NCDs. It is a wonder drug. So going back in the literature, if you see, aspirin had been used by even about 4,000 years ago, 2000 BC by the Sumerian. Now this is derived from the plant willow. From the willow leaves and the barks to treat inflammation. And if you go further down in history, even ancient Egyptian documents, this papyrus leaf that I have given here, documents the use of aspirin for pain relief. Further down the history, even Hippocrates is known to have used this the willow leaf tea to ease the pain of women that are giving birth. So you can see that this has been in existence for many, many years. But when did Western medicine or Western medical practice start to notice this? In the year 1763 is the first time we find a publication in relation to the use of willow, published by the Royal Society, where a vicar by the name of Edward Stone in Oxford used this substance for the treatment of pain and inflammation. However, several years down the line, in the 1800s, it is only during that time we were able to extract the active ingredient, which was named by Joseph Buchner as salicylin, which we now know as aspirin. And the first clinical trial, I was able to dig up this document going through the archives of the Lancet, the famous medical journal. The first clinical trial on use of this salicylin for fever and joint inflammation in patients with rheumatism was published in 1876, so long time ago, right? Further down the line, people then started to appreciate that this use of salicylin lead to GI adverse effects. Then the pharmaceutical companies took it up, and they, to minimize this adverse effect, they added this acetyl group and patent that process. Of course, they can't patent the plant. What they did was they patent the addition of this acetyl group to the salicylic acid and obtained the patent. And then finally, this was available in the market as aspirin in the late 1800s. Now you can see, even though the Western medical practice picked this up somewhere in the 1800s, to build up the evidence. Now at the moment, the main use of aspirin is as an antiplatelet drug, right? So to build up that evidence for the current use, how many years it has taken? Nearly 100 to 150 years. But the process, so what I want you to appreciate is this is not a thing that you can do overnight. It takes a long time to generate evidence, to build up evidence. So when you follow the process, I mean, I know that nowadays the science has advanced, the technology is advanced, so the extraction processes and all that probably we can do faster than what we did earlier. But still, to generate the evidence, you have to conduct clinical trials. So that takes a little bit of time. So you can't rush these things. So that is the first message I want you to pick up from the story of aspirin. The second thing is the fact that we should not ignore the signals that are coming from herbal or native medical treatments. Now imagine if this has been used, the willow bark and the leaves had been used for pain relief nearly 4,000 years ago, right? So even now, I'm sure there are many signals that are coming from herbal medicines, which has their own merits. So we should not ignore the Western medical practitioners should not simply ignore the signals that are coming from that. Then the third message is, now this, if you look at the process, there are two key things that had been done in the development of aspirin. Number one, they took the plant and were able to identify what we call the active ingredient, right? And then they looked at the active ingredient and they saw that this produces few adverse effects. To minimize that, they did certain chemical modifications. So this is an integral part of medicine's development when it comes to Western medicine. We always talk about extraction of active ingredients, chemical modifications, and further improvements and evolution. So, but we have now, you will understand as I go along in my presentation, it has come to a time point where we need to think a little different from the standard approach when we are thinking of adopting the herbal medicines or native medical treatments for into our Western medical practice. Now, this is an important thing. I'm sure most of you who have joined online know this pyramid. We call this the evidence-based pyramid, right? Now, earlier days, even the Western medical practices would have been at the bottom of this pyramid. Whatever the practices we did would have been based on expert opinion, a set of patients that have been treated by the Western medical practitioners or in his own experience. So, but where Western medicine has now started to differentiate from the native treatments is that now we have built up this pyramid of evidence where we have a hierarchy, which we can say. So we trust the evidence that are coming from randomized control trials as opposed to expert opinions. And then further down, the best evidence, I would say, is something coming from systematic reviews and meta-analysis, right? So this is one key distinction that I see between the native treatments and the Western medical practice, where the herbal or the native treatments also need to think about evolving. Like, I mean, I know that there are a lot of things that are being done. There are people interested even in Sri Lanka from the native medical practices who are doing a lot of good research. So that is what is required to generate this kind of evidence. Randomized control studies, and then ultimately even the evidence coming from a single randomized control trial will not be enough. You will need to replicate the results, which is one of the important things in science. Whatever the findings need to be replicated, that is when things can be taken as valid. So this we need to seriously think about, especially the native medical treatments. We need to move beyond expert opinions and case series and think about randomized control trials, systematic reviews, and meta-analysis. Right, so there I wanted to highlight to you a few key principles involved in the development of herbal medicines for into the Western practice, right? Now, let me take you through the process. I will take a personal example because I have been involved with cinnamon for some time now. nearly about 10 years. So when you take cinnamon in the native medical practices, it is considered as a treatment for many conditions. It is considered to have antimicrobial properties, antiparasitic properties, considered antioxidant. But the interesting fact that we picked up is this blood glucose rolling activity and the beneficial cardiovascular effects. All this interest happened with this clinical trial. This was a trial done in Pakistan, conducted in collaboration with the USA. I think in the year 2003, where they found that this was a clinical trial. So they found that cinnamon, when you give it to patients with type 2 diabetes, it improves glucose, blood glucose control, as well as the serum lipid parameters, right? But the thing is, now when it comes to cinnamon, there are two types of products that are available. What they used in the clinical trial is what is commonly available in the world market, what we call the Chinese cinnamon or the cassia, right? What we have available in Sri Lanka is what is known as the true cinnamon or Ceylon cinnamon, right? There is an important difference between these two. That is in their coumarin content, where there is high levels of coumarin in the Chinese cinnamon and negligible levels in the Ceylon cinnamon. So what is the problem with coumarin? Now, if you take diabetes, this is an illness that requires long-term treatment. This is not a one-off thing like a communicable disease. So when people start using this long-term in high doses, there is a potential to cause liver toxicity. So with this clinical trial, a lot of people started using cinnamon as a supplement. There were a lot of cinnamon products available in the Western market. And then people started to notice this, which led to several European organizations, including the European Food Safety Association, agency, coming out with recommendations saying that you should not use cinnamon as a regular supplement for management of diabetes because of the coumarin issue. So this is where we picked up. So we thought, why not? Since Ceylon cinnamon does not contain coumarin, if we can replicate the findings in Ceylon cinnamon, there will be a huge benefit for the country as a whole, right? So where did we start? In any herbal medicine, for that matter, any research, don't ever forget, you cannot replace a good literature review, right? So that is the first step where we started. So we looked at the literature. A literature review will give you the current evidence, and it will also point you towards the starting point, because it is unlikely, highly unlikely in the today's developed world, that you will be the first one to come up with the idea. I can guarantee to you, there will be literature somewhere where somebody has thought of this and done some sort of research. So doing a good literature review will solve a lot of your problems. It can tell you where to start. It can tell you what are the starting doses of that you can use if it is a clinical trial, and so on. And then people always talk, in the scientific community, people always talk about publication, and spending your time on a literature review is not a waste, because you can publish this. If you do it following a systematic process, you can see that we have published all the literature reviews we have done as systematic reviews. So if you follow a systematic process, you can certainly publish this. So what did we see with Ceylon cinnamon? We saw that there is a gap. The entire literature contained only in vitro studies. Was there a potential? Yes, there was. Because if you look at this diagram, Ceylon cinnamon either positively or negatively influences certain key enzymes that are involved in the metabolism of glucose. So definitely there is a potential for Ceylon cinnamon to reduce blood sugar. However, there were no human trials. We only ended up finding in vivo, but animal studies, which we did analyze further and did a meta-analysis. And we saw that even among animals, there was a beneficial glycemic effect when you gave Ceylon cinnamon. So now it was time to move, for us to move and generate evidence in humans. So where did we start? Obviously, you will think now there is in vitro evidence, there is evidence in animal studies. So obviously we should be now starting with human trials, right? So that was not the case. We wanted to test this out in animals beforehand because the dose that we were planning to use, we felt was little higher than what we regularly consume and what has been done because we wanted to replicate the dose that had been used by the Pakistan study, right? So because of that, we thought, okay, we will look at an animal study first, look at the safety and the effectiveness. So we took a rat model and we took some healthy and diabetes-induced rats and looked at their safety and the efficacy, right? Which are both important things to stress. So we did not find any toxicity in the animals. They tolerated the higher doses we planned to use in the clinical trials. And on top of that, more importantly, we noticed that there was a beneficial effect even in the diabetes-induced group. So with that, we thought, okay, now we can move on to do a clinical trial in humans. So where did we start? Obviously, clinical trials, you know, there are several phases, phase 1, 2, 3. Now the problem is people try to skip all these stages. They go from literature review to post-marketing and skip preclinical, clinical, and all that. So that is the problem that we see nowadays, right? So we went on to do a phase 1 clinical trial where we now took this extract and made it into a capsule. Put it into the capsule. And another important thing that you need to understand, ladies and gentlemen, is the importance of quality testing. That is also something that we need to think about when doing herbal derived products. You always need to see, now in Western medical practices, we talk about a lot of quality standards. We compare with the standards that are published in the pharmacopoeia, right? So here also, you need to conduct quality testing to ensure that your product is of the required standard. So we did that in the development of this material, in the development of this capsule, and completed the phase 1 trial for a duration of 3 months, which was a dose escalation study. So these are the doses we plan to use from the extract. Remember, the Pakistani group used crude cinnamon. Now, for those who are interested, the doses that they used were 1, 3, and 6 grams. And the beneficial effects were seen in the doses of 3 and 6 grams, right? So if you are using crude cinnamon, but what we used was an extract. So there we did a dosing calculation and came up with these doses. Interesting thing we noticed in the healthy group is that even in that group, there was a beneficial reduction in the cholesterol. So take that into account. The cholesterol benefits were shown in the Chinese cinnamon. And we also were able to replicate that in the Ceylon cinnamon. So we published these results. Anybody interested can go through. These are already published. Then we moved on to a phase 2-3 combined trial where we, as a randomized control study, we study 210 patients with diabetes. And there also we saw a beneficial reduction in the blood glucose and importantly, a 0.5% reduction in the HbA1c. Where this 0.5% stands, I will show you in a little while. And in addition to that, we saw, again, the hypolipidemic effect was replicated in the diabetic group. Remember, dyspepsia is one of the adverse effects. So if you are having dyspepsia, it may not be the best to use these doses of cinnamon. Right, moving on. So in conclusion, cinnamon, definitely. So I have taken you through the process where you do a literature review, then start off with the preclinical and then move on down the line, generating evidence, right? How long does this take? As I explained to you earlier, you cannot rush these things. A preclinical trial probably takes about 4 years and the clinical trials may be up to 10 years. And then once you do that, regulatory approval further 1 to 2 years, right? Personally, how long did it take for me? Still, we have not registered this product. It's not available in the market. So from 2010, we have been doing these studies. You can see next year, it will be the 11th year. So it takes time, you know, you can't rush these things. Take the example of aspirin. You cannot trust these things, right? You have to understand this standard systematic process has to be followed for this development. Now I am coming to the third part of my presentation where I will look at evidence from commonly used herbal medical products that are in the literature. So first I will look at the obesity, which is the cornerstone for many non-communicable diseases. Again, we did the research. We went to the open market and obtained these weight loss supplements that are there, right? And you will be surprised to see in the Sri Lankan market, as over-the-counter preparations, there are 100 products that are available, 100 different products that are available as weight loss supplements. What are the common? So they not only contain herbal ingredients, there are various other things that are there, but what are the common herbal ingredients? These are what we found. Green tea, and then garcinia, caffeine, cinnamon, ginger. These are the common things that you find. Now let's look at the literature. What does the literature say about these products? Green tea. So I was able to dig up this systematic review. So I will be basing my recommendations and the recommendations on these products based on systematic reviews, which is the highest level of evidence. So green tea, the weight reduction is in a systematic review is only 0.65 kilograms. Although that was significant, you go and ask any nutritionist or anybody who is involved in weight loss management, you need to reduce at least 5 to 10% of your body weight to obtain any beneficial metabolic effects. So whether this, although this 0.65 is significant, whether that translates into beneficial medicinal effects or metabolic effects is really questionable. And for those who are interested, I have given the doses that are here. I'm sure we can share these presentations at the end. I have given the doses that have been used in these clinical trials, so a wide variety of doses from 450 milligrams to 20,000 milligrams per day, right? So the evidence is doubtful, right? And then garcinia for weight, what we call goraka. Again, there was a meta-analysis and systematic review. What is the reduction in weight? Reduction in weight was slightly higher, but the problem is this is resulting from a lesser number of trials. Earlier one had 20 clinical trials. Here we are only talking about 500 patients, limited duration, 8 to 12 weeks. Anybody would say that the important thing about waist loss is maintaining the weight loss. So that is a problem when it comes to this. And here again, I have given the doses. Ginger, again, the same thing. You see a significant weight loss in the meta-analysis, but whether that significant weight loss translates into metabolic benefit, I highly doubt. But we still need to do more studies because we are talking about evidence from only 473 people, even in the systematic review. And the duration is only 12 weeks. So we don't know whether this weight reduction will be sustained in the long run. What about evidence for diabetes? Karawila, a common substance that we use. Sorry, Kothala Himbutu, common substance that we used. Again, I could not find a meta-analysis on this. So anybody interested in doing research on this, that is a good topic to do. You can conduct a systematic review and meta-analysis. There are clinical trials on this. I was able to dig up 3 studies coming from this review published where Kothala Himbutu reduces HbA1c by 0.4 to 0.51 range, but there was no meta-analysis. These were significant, but we have to keep in mind only 3 studies with a very small sample size, only 71 participants in total, right? Those that they have used was 250 milligrams per day. What about Karawila? There was a little bit more evidence where there was a systematic review and meta-analysis. Fasting blood sugar reduction, 13 milligrams per deciliter, HbA1c 0.26. They have used 2 to 6 grams. So where does that stand with the existing treatment? Now, these are the existing treatments for diabetes. We know that the drugs like metformin and then the sulfonylureas, they reduce HbA1c by 1 to 2%. They are the high efficacy drugs. A 0.5% or less than 0.5%, which have been seen in these medicines, might not be enough to use them as all therapeutic agents. Maybe they can supplement these medicines, but still we have to study the interactions and the adverse effects that we have to keep in mind. Another common substance, tebu, right? Used in Sri Lanka. Again, I did not find any meta-analysis, only a review article was there. So again, somebody interested can pick up on this and conduct a systematic review. evidence is questionable. I couldn't find any human trials. So you can see, ladies and gentlemen, even the existing products that we use nowadays for management of obesity and diabetes, although there is some evidence, which I showed to you with the doses that they have used, whether that translates into beneficial metabolic effects as a sole therapy, I do not know. We need further studies, maybe with higher doses, but we can certainly look at active ingredients and try to improve on this. So there is a good signal, but we need to further improve, right? So I'm coming to the final parts of my presentation now. So these are the common issues that we face when developing herbal medicines. The quality issues need to be addressed. Quality control is very important. Lack of trained personnel and instruments. When we talk about extraction and identification of active ingredients, that is a hurdle that we are facing now with the development of cinnamon. So these are common issues that need to be addressed when we are trying to adopt herbal medical treatments into the Western medical practice. Just for those who are interested, this is the process of conducting clinical trials in Sri Lanka. You need to get approval from all these organizations. Right, finally, my recommendations. Is there a potential? Definitely there is, but we need to do a lot more. We need to make available a lot of funding because this takes time, effort, and money. And we need to clear the logistical barriers because people will be interested in obtaining patents, which are greatly delayed. The review processes need to be expedited to shorten the time duration. And we need to get the expertise by collaborating with local and international agencies and with the traditional medical practitioners. At the moment, this is how allopathic and traditional medicine stands. But we need to move forward and come to a harmony. Only by doing that, we can eliminate the quacks and the opportunists who are taking advantages of our poor people because of the lack of evidence. So with that message, I will end my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Priyangath, and thank you for showing the rigorous and the scientific process that has to be followed. Before we move into the next presentation, I would like to make a comment on this. One is actually from the very beginning of COVID. I mean, even though we are not discussing COVID, one thing I want to mention is that as the National Medical Association, we strongly believe on the rational and the scientific approach and the ethical approach. And from the very beginning, the SLM Ethics Committee, as well as Sri Lanka Clinical Trials Registry, has introduced expedite pathways for testing of any remedies. I mean, the basic principles are not diverted, but they are considered national need. There was an expedited pathway that was introduced. That's number one comment. Number two is now there seems to be an unfortunate perception that there is Western science and Eastern science. But having said that, the science is something that has been progress over time, maybe started from the Eastern and then moved into Western, maybe the Middle East and maybe Europe. So at the moment, most of the frontiers in science at the moment may be basically conquered by the West. But having said that, I mean, science is actually science and it belongs to the humanity. And it's a whole knowledge base. And there is a scientific process that has been evolved. So can any system deviate from that scientific process that has evolved over time?
Yeah, so I don't think so, because what has happened is with the evolution of science and technology, even the scientific process and the discipline has evolved to an extent where you cannot deviate. I showed you the evidence pyramid, sir, so I mean, to the audience also, that is where we should aim. I mean, in the earlier years, maybe 200 years ago, we could have based everything on expert opinions and personal advice on things like that. But nowadays, science is more advanced. Science has, not that the scientific process has evolved, scientific process has always been the same about generating evidence, but the science is now advanced where people now don't depend on personal expertise and experiences. You need to generate evidence.
Thank you, Dr. Priyanka. And if the audience, if you want to ask questions, we can take them at the end of the two presentations. But if you want to send your comments, you can do so that we can divert them and ask from the experts who are here. I'll hand over to my co-chairperson, Dr. Shantiyathimala, to introduce the next speaker.
I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Senatha Pilapitiya. He has MBBS MP in medicine. And he is the dean and the senior lecturer at the Faculty of Medicine, Rajaratna University. And he also has an interesting affiliation. He has a diploma in Ayurvedic, in Ayurveda from the Department of Family.
Thank you. I think we had a very interesting presentation on how the science is dealing with traditional medicines. And then, of course, in the last slide, it was presented by Dr. Priyanga that, you know, in order to have a successful journey, that these two sectors, the modern medicine and traditional medicine, should merge to a certain extent if we are to tread through this path in an effective and successful way. So I will start from there, and what I will be trying to elaborate on is how can we merge on this direction, and in order to do so, what should we be doing? So one important thing that I will try to highlight during my presentation would be that to give a brief account on what fundamental principles of traditional medicines govern the thinking and the knowledge on dealing with non-communicable diseases. So unless we are able to appreciate this, you know, principles which governs their model of intervention and their model of deciding on what herbs to be, you know, compounded or to be used in a solitary manner, we will not be really able to appreciate what is exactly going with traditional medicines. And we might not also be able to harness that knowledge to the modern perspectives of validation and establishing a kind of a evidence-based practice in relation to herbs and traditional medicines. So when you take the domain of non-communicable diseases, there are few important concepts in Ayurveda upon which the decisions are taken. So these are actually, you will see a slight deviation from the kind of knowledge that we deal with, but most of them are kind in a conceptual framework. Those are not the kind of knowledge that we could analyze in the laboratory setting and so on, but these knowledge bases has evolved in a, you know, using conceptual frameworks. So when it comes to non-communicable diseases, in Ayurveda, they have this concept of Agni. Now the Agni, if you take by Sanskrit or Pali, even in Sinhala, Agni is a synonymous with fire. And this is one very important concept that governs the entire disease manifestations of communicable diseases in Ayurveda. And this Agni, they have three components. One is called the Jatara Agni, that if you really analyze it and see, it falls in parallel, not exactly the same, but falls in parallel with the digestive processes that we speak of. So in according to Ayurveda, this Jatara Agni plays an important role in, you know, gradual manifestation or, you know, making your body more prone for communicable diseases. So the digestive process, they have their concepts and they give it a kind of a very prominence in relation to non-communicable diseases. Then you have the second component of Agni, which is called the Dhatva Agni. Dhatva Agni is the Agni at tissue level. And if you really see, you know, go to the depths of this, their knowledge bases and explore, you see they are basically discussing a concept similar to the tissue metabolism what we are speaking of. So And then they also have the third component of Agni, which is called Bhuta Agni. So that is the Bhuta is what is the elemental level that they discuss of at an elemental level. So in fact, again, if you really try to parallel it, it could be something like the cellular metabolism that we are speaking of. So you see, and it is quite interesting to see, they say the entire Kaya Chikitsa or internal medicine of Ayurveda is about 95% consists of dealing with Agni. And so it is like if you try to interpret in modern kind of thinking patterns, so they say your entire Kaya Chikitsa or internal medicine is a issue of dealing with your digestion and metabolic processes, so metabolism. So all their interventions in relation to the prevention of non-communicable diseases is partly based on dealing with Agni or the digestive process or the metabolism in the body. So they will try to meddle it using their herbs or herbal, you know, compounds or behaviors or in the dietary patterns. So this is one important concept that they speak of. Then they say in non-communicable diseases, how do they get, you know, how do they origin? So that is, their explanation is, when your Agni is impaired, that is the Jatara Agni, that is the digestive process is impaired, and also the other Agnis, that is like the tissue and elemental level metabolism, or the Bhuta Agni and the Dhatva Agni is impaired, the body accumulates a state called armor. And again, this armor is a very complex and detailed concept in Ayurveda, but if you really go to the depths and try to analyze it, it is somewhat kind of a, you know, pro-inflammatory state that is speaking of. So it says if your metabolism is impaired and if your digestive processes are impaired over a duration of time, over a longer duration, your body might get into the state of armor. Or, you know, a parallel that we could, these are, when I use the parallels, you have to understand these two will not be synonymous. And you can't do that when you are dealing with two subjects. And in fact, this is a common phenomena in science. Even if you talk in physics, they have this principle of what you call the incommensurability. So there can be, for the same physical phenomena, you can have two or three theories like the Newtonian theory and so on. These are not exactly explained one by the other. And if you can do so, you can throw out one and keep one, and that will be the superior one. So this is, again, we will have to understand whenever we are dealing with two knowledge bases, we will not be able to say the exact kind of, you know, conversion or, you know, the exact term for this. But when you are here, we are dealing with a more of a kind of a conceptual model. And then in Western medicine, of course, we have a very clear kind of a mechanistic model. So coming back to armor, so it's the body gets into a kind of a armor state or a pro-inflammatory state. And this, it says, is the origin of all non-communicable diseases. So this is what Ayurveda believes. And then, of course, as a result of that, then they have this, the third concept is the Srota. Srota is micro and macro channels at tissue, in the tissue and the body. So they say, as the armor gets accumulated or developed in the body, there is a process of, you know, ultimately these Srotas or the micro and the macro channels will start getting occluded, and there will be malfunction at cellular and tissue level, giving rise to the diseases. And if you really see, they have even gone to the extent of explaining the manifestation from the very beginning up to the, of a particular non-communicable disease until it manifests as symptoms and signs. So there are again five stages that they have explained, such as Sanchaya, that is accumulation. Accumulative stage. Of course, at that stage, no one is ill. You don't have any clinical manifestations. Your body is fairly okay. But the disease process has started. So there is this stage of Sanchaya. And then there is a state of Prakopa, where it is more now is starting to get, you know, started to spread through the channels and so on. And there will be Sthana Samshreya. So it will get into a particular, you know, organ or a site where it will start developing the, you know, originating the whatever the disease or the manifestation. And then there is a fourth stage where it will manifest. And then, of course, after that, it will either destroy the involved tissue or the organ or the body, or if you are treated, of course, it will start reversing. So this is the process of manifestation. So you see, these knowledge bases like Ayurveda have their own explanations for the manifestations of diseases, and it is based on that they have decided the interventions. So how now, we in the previous presentation we saw that, you know, there are certain herbs which are there in the traditional medical base, and when we really go and explore, we see certain, you know, beneficial effects in relation to what they have also assumed as, you know, conditions, what they have assumed as being effective. So how have they generated knowledge? Now we know how we generate our knowledge and we establish our knowledge in the modern context of the science. But how did they do? How did they knew that cinnamon would be good in particular situations? So they also had their own, again, this conceptual frameworks and certain, you know, way of analyzing these things. And so when it comes to a herb, now, of course, I have just tried to deal with the manifestations of NCD and what is their thinking based, you know, based on their principles and how do they take decisions. So how do they decide which herb is good or which, you know, herbal compound would be good? So again, like in modern day pharmacology, they also have their ways of analyzing herbs. So for each herb, they will have about, you know, they have what you call as rasa, guna, virya, vipaka, and prabhava. Rasa is that is a you know, way that what it will, the property of that particular herb, which will bring about a action within the body, is rasa. Guna is like what sort of a, you know, this action which will take place, what sort of a change will it bring about. So virya is the potency. So you might have a herb which has rasa guna, but potency is less, so that you do not, you know, expect that it to bring about the kind of change that you want inside the body. Then of course, like so on. And then they have what you call the prabhava, that is where, you know, a property that would not be explained from the other, by the other four properties. So it's a special property of that herb. So all these are being explained within their context of what we call as the dravya guna vijnana, that is the knowledge about, you know, the manifestations and the impact of herbs on the human body. So this is how they have you know, formulated their herbal interventions, be it a single herb or a compound herb. And when you see now, since why I explained all these principles is, when they decide on interventions, they have a kind of a holistic intervention. So if you are to deal with Agni, the digestive thing, they will say, you know, a dietary modification. So they always go as Ahara, Viharana, and Aushadha. Ahara is your diet. Viharana is your behavioral modifications. Aushadha is your drugs. So they will have all three modalities being utilized to intervene with the manifestations of disease. And even the treatment will start on different stages. Earlier we said that according to them, there is a Sanchay state or the accumulative state. So sometimes some of the interventions might go and try to break down the origin of disease at that particular stage. And they might put up your Agni or the digestive process and the metabolism in proper level, you know, proper form. And therefore, whatever the disease that you were going to manifest will get reversed and you will remain healthy. And then, of course, so based on the stage of the disease or the stage of the manifestation of the disease, the intervention will change. So now this is the concept of dealing with non-communicable diseases in traditional medicines like Ayurveda. And so when your interventions also, it is very you know, it is not very common to see that they would be using a single ingredient, you know, that what they call as the ekiya dravya. And there are only very few ekiya dravyas in Ayurveda, like aloe vera, cinnamon and ginger, which have been prescribed as treatments. Most of the time, those are compounds. And also, it will not stop with a single compound, it will be several. And that is why I, again, you know, these principles are important. There will be one compound dealing with Agni and another behavioral intervention, you know, trying to help that. There will be another compound or a intervention which will be dealing with the stage of the disease and trying to reverse it back. And there will be certain others which will deal with whatever the shrotas or the channels that were obstructed. So this is their entire pattern of thinking when dealing with non-communicable diseases. So what we see today is we try to pick up one or two and we try to validate it within our framework, which is a good thing because that is one way forward. But that alone will take a lot of time to, you know, validate the entire process. So we will have to have a decent understanding on how do they approach this and to what extent can we utilize that knowledge in the modern context. So sometimes there are behavioral modifications, of course, might fall in part, you know, parallel with ours, but certain dietary modifications that they would prescribe would have a, you know, a very valid reason. So doing research on those will be quite important to see how we could deal with non-communicable diseases more effectively than we do. And then, of course, about 25% of this research, I would say, would be the kind of research that we saw in the previous presentation, where they will be, we will be analyzing these ingredients and establishing their evidence and trying to get it within the kind of domain that we practice and to use them as either drugs or supplements and so on. So I think I will just stop there, allowing any further questions, and within that we can clarify if you need further things. So what I tried to tell you is dealing with non-communicable diseases in traditional medicines like Ayurveda, they have very strong concepts, and they have a very, out of the 8 branches of Ayurveda, 2 branches entirely deals with prevention of diseases and healthy aging. Those are called Vajikarna and Rasayana Tantra. And the entire thing, if you go through it, nicely explains how you can, you know, age healthily without developing most of these diseases and how you can promote your health. So out of the 8, 2 are dedicated for that. And they are very quite interesting concepts, you know, in this, when we know the science and when we go and explore, there's quite a lot that is interesting. And of course, if we are sensitive to those, we might be able to use those in providing care for the NCDs in a much more effective way in a country like ours, where there is a socio-cultural, you know, acceptance of these systems. But then, as in the previous lecture, we also have to be very careful and tread through the scientific path so that we assure that, you know, the standards and the proper scientific approaches are maintained. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pilipitiya, for providing a very valuable comparison. Now, during the remaining time, we can have a session to discuss. I saw Dr. Raghunathan wanted to make a comment. If you are there, you can make the comment, Dr. Raghunathan. Or else you can ask your questions as comments in the chat.
First of all, let me congratulate SLMA and Professor Indika Karunathilaka for this very timely discussion. Actually, I came with a very negative mind to see this presentation. I thought it was very untimely, knowing all these all these things happening. But after listening to these two speakers, I'm glad that you have done the right thing. this is the scientific way to go. But hats off to all the presenters, but my question or comment to Dr. Priyanka Ranasinghe, I totally understood and agreed with your presentation and the way how the herbal medicine and how things should be looked at. But yeah, so my question is this, though this is not related directly, my question related to NCD, but since this is timely, came at the time, and Dr. Professor Indika Karnatilaka also mentioned about COVID and the medicine which the state or somebody is trying to present. There was a big problem which, as CCP and SLMA, lots of people are worried. Why? Because this particular medicine, which is not Ayurvedic, which is not maybe you call it traditional, the amount of thing which is coming. But why the 10 experts? I am sure Dr. Professor Senaka Pillapiti also, I heard in that committee, which has agreed to look at this on a scientific way. But there is no way we could get an answer to this question in a scientific way. And also, if you know, was there a need to look at this the way it was promoted by the media? There is no need, because you know, anybody coming and telling this is better than that, are we going to have a control trial? Or not, because of this state is wanting. My question is that why did the 10 experts, I know they all are experts and which are very valuable, why didn't they protest at least the way the scientific, the way the, it was presented as it is scientific, the placebo arm 100% not curing and the treatment are 100% effective. So this is totally unscientific. Why there was no protest from any of the 10 people before they agree, and didn't they say to the state, this cannot be done in a hurry? Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the comment. I think I agree with you because the important thing to understand is that we cannot trust these things, and that we have to follow the scientific process. So I'm sure the expert committee will look at this in that manner. As I said earlier, you have to look at what are the ingredients that are there, and then you have to look at the literature. Of course, now since they have been given the task of looking at this, I don't think they can simply reject it maybe. So they will have to look at it. I agree with you, sir. I mean, you have to follow the normal standard process. This is the problem. Our media also has a big role to play in this. When you glorify this to the people, I mean, now we know there are two or three or four, even four of these products that have come up with people trying to exploit, you know,
exactly,
and trying to grab this opportunity to make some money. So that we have to be careful. I mean, at the end of the day, since this may be used for a communicable disease, this may not be used long-term like a non-communicable disease. So there may not be harmful effects if you take it once, but still, at the end of the day, we should not allow our popular people to be exploited in this way by following unscientific principles. So I totally agree with you. I think Professor Indika can also add to this.
I thank Dr. Raghunathan for bringing up that issue. Actually, there was a lot of discussion at SLMA before we decide on this symposium, because at the moment there are a lot of controversies. As I have mentioned previously, there are a lot of unethical practices that are happening. But then we felt this would be a good time to start a discussion and then to discuss on what should be the scientific and the rational approach. I completely agree with you that there cannot be any deviation from the accepted ethical or the scientific protocols or practices. So I actually take a slightly different take on from Dr. Priyanka there, because I believe the starting point should be accepting that wrong is wrong.
Exactly.
Something unethical has happened. I mean, if
if unproven medicine was tested on patients in whatever hospital, I think the starting point should have been wrong is wrong. And then appointing a committee in a way is should not be the pathway. I mean, the whatever we do, it has to be in the accepted scientific and rational and ethical pathways. It is all because it's all about patient safety. And it is all about the public health approach in the current pandemic. And there should not be any deviation from the tested and scientifically proven pathways and the strategies that the country's taken. So in that way, I think there are a lot of concerns. I mean, this is my personal opinion that the starting point should be accepting what is wrong and then moving into proper scientific pathways.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
And to it, sir, since I'm a member of that committee, I thought I will just briefly explain what really went and what is the purview. Of course, we have not been speaking on this to the media because it has already become a very kind of a controversial thing. And so as the expert committee, and we thought we will keep silence till we finish our duty, which was called upon. And another clarification, I'm still not a professor, sir. I'm just the senior lecturer. So so what really happened was, actually, we all know what came up with this situation. And I think we were asked by the Ministry of Health to conduct this research. And actually, as you said, why did we agree or why did we took the responsibility is like, this was a situation where, you know, there are a lot of so many traditional recipes and so on. And for a reason that was, you know, partly contributed by our own sector, there was a huge uproar in the community, and this was going out of the control. So what I think is, as a Ministry of Health, they have a responsibility to make sure that they give a kind of an informed decision to the public. And the way out for them is to ask for an expert committee to evaluate within the proper scientific framework. And so we also had two options, either to run away from the situation or else to take the challenge and do it, get the challenge and do it in the best scientific way and give our opinions to the Ministry of Health so that they can decide on how to, you know, handle this issue. So that was our intention of, you know, accepting it, because why we accepted. For things. And then, of course, as you know, in the history also, when you have evidence that has been generated with improper way, one way is to not to look into it. And I can assure that the committee, we did not look into any of these evidences because we do not believe that were generated or whatever that was done in the proper scientific or the ethical way. So we kept out that whole thing out of our context. We didn't went to, you know, we didn't venture into answering it or looking at it even, but we went with the responsibility that was given to us. And then again, when doing so, what we thought was there are so many traditional medical recipes in the community and, you know, historically which have been there and so on. So it is up to the Department of Ayurveda, who is responsible, to see whether it is worth even exploring. So we didn't went into finding out whether it is worthwhile to explore or not. We gave that responsibility as a government institute for the Department of Ayurveda to see the recipe and all the preparation and everything and tell the Ministry of Health and the research team whether it is at least, you know, whether they want it to be studied properly or whether there is even at least a basic rationale for a recipe like that. So I think that they have appointed expert committee and they have done it and they have informed that it can be recommended for this thing. So it is, we have given the total responsibility of deciding whether it is worthwhile researching or not and whether it should be or not to the Department of Ayurveda with their experts, and they have their own formulary committee and so on. So if they give their recommendations, of course, we will formulate the model within our scientific framework to make sure that it is done in the most ethical way with all the ethical clearances and the scientific way, and then of course deliver our results again to the institute that is concerned, that is the Ministry of Health. So that is what is happening now at the moment, and why we actually did not come with all these details. There was issues related to this at the community level. And since this is a medical forum and a forum of medical professionals within our this thing, I think I can share this the thought process as well as the reasons why we got into this, as well as what happened.
Yeah, thank you very much, Indika and both of you. Hats off to you. But as a senior physician, I need to tell one thing. Actually, wrong is wrong. I am glad that Indika, as a personal level, he is telling that. But as Ceylon College of Physicians and SLMA, we have the responsibility to tell to the society that this is wrong. And the wrong is wrong. And there is no, while I totally agree with what Senaka is telling about Ayurvedic medicine going to say, but the start is wrong. And that must be, we need to give at least a statement from the SLMA and CCP probably. Unfortunately, the CCP president but one of the past presidents, someone is there. But I think we have a responsibility to tell the public, what happened due to the Vedapathy. A media conference by Ceylon College of Physicians broke the whole thing. So why not SLMA or NCCP or both together say that this evidence which is given by the media is totally unscientific? Why don't we have the guts to say that? And we must, I personally demand SLMA, and I have given up on everything after talking to
there's some feedback coming.
Okay, thank you.
I just wanted to add one more thing. I also totally agree with Professor Indika that what is wrong, we have to declare what is wrong is completely wrong. And I will go one step further. Actually, I think the now we know that human experimentation had been conducted without obtaining proper approval. So we need to go one step further and hold those who are responsible accountable for their actions. I mean, we can't go back to the stage of where unethical human experimentation was done without their knowledge and permission. So I think we need to think about those also from the health ministry side, if medical doctors were involved, to for them to have them to be held accountable for their actions.
Thank you very much.
If there are any other questions, you can send them in the chat also. Okay, there is a question to Dr. Pillapitiya that how do you suggest we bridge the paradigms and we have find a new ground to carry out your suggestions. So what Dr. Dini Labhegunathan is asking is, what is the way forward that you are suggesting as a practitioner of both crafts, that as most of us are aware that you are qualified in both. So what do you think, what's the way forward?
Yeah, I think way forward is to be, so I just tried to explain how their decision making takes place. So first to appreciate that their decisions also are made on a kind of a logical reasoning path rather than just being accumulated over time due to past experiences or that certain, it's a knowledge base that has evolved just over time with trial and error. So first thing we will have to appreciate is that. Then the second is to allow that their fundamental principles to be appreciated within the framework. And this is also valid for researching. So for example, when we research, we always tend to try find out the active ingredients or a kind of a single intervention, whereas their intervention by fundamental principles itself is a kind of a holistic approach. So unless we appreciate that in research, what we could get out from that domain is quite limited. And over time, over I think last 30, 40 years, there has been a lot of research being done in relation to traditional medicine in other countries. And even if you see the stand of the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine in US, when you saw their objectives in 1995, and when you read the objectives in somewhere around 2008, there was a drastic shift from what they initially thought. So they have in fact included that they try to understand the fundamental principles of these traditional medicines, and that the research should be curtailed into that. So there are a few, you know, such studies done in published studies as well. There was one a classical study, that a pilot study done on rheumatoid arthritis. In that model, they have allowed, you know, the physicians to use the drugs upon their discretion, and about, I think, 40 or 50 combinations have been allowed to be used based on their prakriti or the, you know, body temperaments, they say, the vata, pitta and kapha, and there are different mixtures of that based on that. And then only they have, the end results have been compared with the standard intervention with the methotrexate and so on, and where the interventions that done in the traditional medicine. So certain, you know, research models will have to be, you know, put in place if you are to explore these sciences and, you know, get a kind of a good result of out of it. So it's one path is to go with the singleton agents. One is to test the model and see. So for that, of course, we have to be a bit accommodative and kind of a broad-minded if you are to tread in that path. So it's kind of a, you know, that is what we need.
Thank you. I think there's another related question also, that what do you think about the WHO guidelines on testing for herbal medicines? Maybe Dr. Priyanka can answer that question.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. WHO has published several guidelines. This is nothing new. I think from 2000 onwards, there are about three guidelines on the 2000 up to 2007, I think, on the assessing the efficacy, safety, and also the importantly the quality of herbal and traditional medicines with regards to their effectiveness and so on. So that is a good starting point, you know, we might have to see how we adopt it to our practices. Now this is, WHO has taken this step because this is not a problem in Sri Lanka alone. Even in other countries, there are established traditional medical practices. As I said before at the start of my presentation, there is a value in all these practices. We cannot simply ignore because they have been practiced over thousands of years. There is definitely a value. If you take the story of aspirin, for example, what a fantastic drug we have ended up with. So you cannot ignore, but we have to follow a rational method. So the WHO guidelines may be a good starting point for Sri Lankans to look at. And I strongly believe we need to have a single focal point where we have experts from both sides when we are looking at these products, not Western alone, not Ayurvedic alone. When we are trying to adopt a harmonized method, maybe both groups need to be involved, and I think the government should take the initiative because we do have a rich tradition and practice. So that we will lose to opportunists and quacks if we don't act quite fast.
I think we are commenting too much. But anyway, I also want to, really kind of compelled to comment on what Priyanka mentioned, that maybe what is happening at the moment can be very damaging to a very useful science that has been there for thousands of years. Dr. Pillapitiya, I want to ask another question from you. With all the due respect to the Ayurvedic system, as you are aware, both you and I have a lot of generational links to the Ayurvedic system as well. So with all that due respect, do you think that the qualified Ayurvedic practitioners should pay more respect to developing their research capacity and system so that they can adapt to the kind of worldwide accepted scientific and ethical practices? I know that many are involved and there's sort of work happening at the Ayurveda Research Institute also. But do you think there need to be more expansion and more capacity building is required in that science?
Yeah, certainly yes. Yes, I totally agree with you. And I think if you see the countries where they have been very successful with this, they have adapted, such models. And then, of course, they have developed capacity. And even say, many of the countries with rich traditional systems have WHO collaborating research centers, be it in India, they have about two or three, China and so on. So, of course, unfortunately, we do not have yet developed to that level. So that is one thing that sector needs, that they will have to develop their capacity. And I'm sure for that, of course, they will need some assistance from the our side as well, because, whenever there is a need for a capacity building, there should be, you know, exchange of experiences and knowledge and assistance. So I think that is where it stands. And if that capacity is there, of course, what we see in today's context, all these, you know, unauthentic traditional formulas coming and all these sorts of things will get under control. So we will have a better kind of a system and a better, you know, contribution from that sector rather than what we see today. Of course, what we see today is a result of not having proper regulations and, you know, lack of capacity within their sector and so on. All that is contributing to what we are seeing today.
Another question. Now going back to NCDs, now according to Western medicine, conditions like hypertension, diabetes, and high cholesterol, they need continuous medication. I mean, there's no cure. But there are, what happens in native medicine? There are some people claim cures for diabetes, hypertension. And also the other problem is there are no transparencies.
Yeah, so I think, yeah, that these are issues of not being regulated adequately. And of course, you know, the weakness of the sector as a whole. Now, if you go to you asked about this non-communicable disease, let me just give a brief account on diabetes, what they have said. You know, according to them, they are, you know, diseases are dealt with several ways. One is there are diseases which can be completely curable. They call it sadhya. Then there are diseases which are uncurable, asadhya. And then there are diseases which should be managed, which is called yapya. And if you see the diabetes, which they come under the domain of madhumeha, under the prameha roga, you know, the texts such as Charaka Sanghita and Sushruta, they are ancient texts. They all mention that this is a disease that needs to be managed, not a cure. And of course, you know, going into detail, they have even explained two types of Ayurveda, which occurs in Stula Balavanta, that is in the obese and, you know, energetic things, like is that kind of a, you know, type 2 diabetes we are thinking of. And the Krusha Daurbalya, that is the lean and weak, you know, they also get diabetes. And in fact, at that time, this is, you know, Charaka has been written about 3,500 years back, compiled. And they say, they have advised the physician not to go and treat the diabetic who is of this Krusha Daurbalya type. You know, there are other features that, you know, a lot of other features been explained. You know, we know that they didn't have insulin at that time. So like, you know, type 1s will anyway die. So they have said by trying to treat them, the physician will get into disrepute because there is nothing you can do. So they have been, you know, if you go to the small letters of these texts and really analyze, they have had a decent knowledge and they have said diabetes is yapya, it's a disease to be managed. But of course, there is one stage which is called the kapaja stage or the initial stage of these obese and this thing. Like even we talk about the state of pre-diabetes and we also know there is a very small percentage if you do all these dietary interventions and behavioral, there might be a, you know, we can delay starting on treatment on in a certain percentage. Similarly, they have also said there is a very minority who might be able to be treated and cured, but that is a very minority. So their texts say that it is a disease that is to be managed. But unfortunately, what we are hearing in the community, in the society, is that, you know, people claiming that diabetes can be cured and so on. That is not what is there in their own system.
Second question, why aren't they transparent? The Ayurvedic medicine, I mean, they don't mention the active ingredient in any, most of the preparations. So they have a common name for this common name without mentioning the active ingredients present in the medicine.
What do you mean by, is it that you are asking about the herbal ingredient?
There's an Arishta, they will call the Nirvi, they give the name of the Arishta, but they don't contain the active ingredients.
No, of course, say if it is a standard Arishta, then of course the pharmacopoeia, there is a pharmacopoeia in Ayurveda, registered with the government of Sri Lanka somewhere in 1974, the first edition has come out, and there is a revision in 1990s. And the pharmacopoeia, if it is a drug that is there in the pharmacopoeia of course, the entire, you know, the recipe and the manufacturing process is declared. So that is the challenge that you ask, you know, or the issue that you ask comes with traditional formulas. Of course, those are kept with the, you know, certain families have their own family traditions and so on. So those are kept as their, you know, trade secrets. Now that, of course, that it is, again, if you want to bring it out and, you know, get the recipes out, we will have to put a framework in place. If in the countries where this has been done, say it in China, on, you know, to a certain extent in India, they have put up a legal framework where you can come and declare your recipe and have your rights of that recipe, you know, like the patenting. So those things have not been still evolved properly in the country. And of course, the only path is to get a patent and so on again. But then we try to patent, you will have a mix of common herbs or, you know, spices in that. And so whether it can be patented or not also becomes an issue. So these are certain, you know, issues that are there, why these traditional, you know, medical practitioners will not come and divulge their recipes immediately. But for the majority, which are the standard drugs, there is the pharmacopoeia, and in that everything is available with the proportions and so on. So to get the rest of the thing into the scene, of course, you will have to put a kind of a standard framework so that, you know, their rights are being, it's like a pharmaceutical industry, when they invent a drug, they will not come and tell the chemical composition, no, within the, you know, unless they have the patented duration is, you know, ended and so on. So those are kind of, those are actually issues that has to be dealt with, you know, legal and all the other frameworks in place. But quite a number, majority, of course, have that.
I think there we are digressing a little bit, because probably we should not be using the word lack of transparency, because I mean, as we are aware, the traditional Ayurvedic system and the legal system in the country, they actually have a system, and they may be different to the allopathic system, but there is a system. Dr. Sena Pilapitiya, correct me if I'm wrong, there is a formulary committee that is registered legally, isn't it? Because that's one question, other question coming, that what's a regulatory system? Can both of you comment on that? I mean, what's a regulatory system that is there to register a herbal medicine in the Ayurvedic system? So how the formulary committee is functioning, and what are the criteria that they are suggesting? And Dr. Priyanga, when it relates to NMR, what are the regulations that they follow? So how these systems overlap and how they can work together. If you can look at it in that way, I think we can look at this in a more positive perspective.
Yeah, so with regards to the NMRA, now these are products that do not fall under the category of standard medicine. So at the NMRA, there is a category called borderline products, which do not consider entirely Ayurvedic preparations, but if it is a product that has vitamins, minerals, and maybe a couple of herbal ingredients, all depends on the composition and the amount and the percentage of various, with these various ingredients. So you can apply for registration through this borderline category if there are herbal preparations, but then still you have to submit the documents in relation to the composition, the different ingredients. And if you are giving certain medicinal claims, you will have to give evidence for those claims. And then the Borderline Medicines Evaluation Committee will look at the application and then decide whether these product, the claims and the product it justifies, whether there is enough evidence before registration. And I know, I think Dr. Pilapitiya can answer to this. Ayurvedic registration also, I think, follows a similar process.
Can Dr. Pilapitiya comment on the Ayurvedic formulary committee and the process that they followed?
Yes, of course, I will give a kind of a overall account, because all the details, I have never sat on that committee as a member or anything. So I can just tell you the basic principles. There is, for any drug that is not in the Ayurveda pharmacopoeia, if it is to be marketed or sold, it has to be approved from the Ayurveda formulary committee. So there cannot be any other drug in the ideal setup in the market which is not approved by the Ayurveda formulary committee. And the Ayurveda formulary committee has its own criteria of evaluating a drug, be it a traditional prescription or a standard Ayurvedic formula. They will have a, in, you know, few basic things that they do is, one, they will you know, look for the literature, whether it is available in any of the literatures that have been, is there in Ola Leaves or anything like that, similar, you know, a kind of a literature search is being done. And they test for toxicological, you know, the presence of toxic substances and heavy metals. So anyone that gets the approval of the Ayurvedic Formulary Committee assured that they will not have the basic, you know, kind of a basic toxicological study is being done. So they will send it to the different laboratories, either the industrial ITI or the Navina Research Institute has, they do certain tests. So those reports has to come to this formulary committee and they will assure that those are negative in that sense. There is, so then of course, they will, it will be evaluated by a panel of experts according to their own, this Dravya Guna Vinyana or their pharmacy kind of, you know, properties and how do you analyze, how they analyze. And if they are satisfied, of course, then they will give. And there is another way of, I think, sometimes they get the views of five or more physicians who have had, if it is a traditional prescription, if they have used it for a long time, if they have experiences, they also can submit their, you know, observations, and all these are being taken into consideration. Then they give it a kind of either as a, you know, food supplement or as a drug, the approval is being given. And then of course, you know, it is within the legal framework that is accepted as a registered Ayurvedic preparation. So there is a framework, and how strong and how lax and all that, of course, I don't know. I have no knowledge to comment, but the framework is there and it is functioning. And of course, I think to a certain level, it is it acts as a regulatory body.
Thank you, Dr. Pilapiti and Dr. Nandu, for a very informative and interesting discussion. I think this will pave the way for further discussions and for the benefit of the for the both Western medicine and Ayurvedic medicine and the humankind. Thank you.
And thank you for all of you. With that, we come to end of this very important webinar. And my heartfelt gratitude goes to the expert committee on non-communicable disease, and especially Dr. Chaturanga Ranasinghe, who wanted to start this discussion, and Dr. Jayanthimala Jayawardhana, the chairperson, because I think this is a much needed discussion in the current context. Even though the starting point was NCD management, I think we have gone into a very useful discussion, and that was a very idea as well, because as the National Medical Association professionals, we should go for a scientific discourse and not for emotions. So, and we have to see how we can collaborate and how we can promote the ethical and scientific practices. And the scientific approach. So that's the whole idea. And with that, I thank all the resource persons and especially all of you, all the participants, for your excellent discussion and the participation. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.